Martin Brundle on Twitter, actually, he just posted.
He just tweeted 27 seconds ago.
And yeah.
Fucked up the whole day.
All right. Martin Brundle, thanks, a guy that I look up to a lot. But
oh, no, this is already tragic.
Well, he says, McLaren say Alonso downshifting while applying full brakes in accident. Unusual to pull for downshifts if you've lost control of a racing car, says he.
I don't know. I've never driven a racing car, but you gotta trust Brundle.
Yeah, well, yeah, Brundle knows a thing or two.
Like, he's been in a few accidents himself.
He says, and this whole thing, it's pretty much the biggest news to come out of testing is this Alonso crash.
Yeah, well, it's overshadowed anything else that would have been big news anyway.
Yeah, for sure.
Seems like he got hurt.
I don't know, a lot of controversy there, but Martin Brundle seems skeptical about this. Rightfully so, I'd say. I mean, most people are skeptical about this.
It seems to be a lot of conspiracies going around about the crash.
I guess we're gonna talk about that in the next little bit to come. Yes, welcome. This is the Flat Out Fever Formula One podcast.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
What episode is it now? Where are we?
We
at
are
now?
Number 8, I think.
Number 8.
Like, of the ones that we're actually showing on the internet, not the failures that preceded them, but
if you thought this was bad,
yeah.
Holy moly!
Let me tell you.
Hey, look at us. We're in HD though.
Yeah. We're not.
I'm not sure if the cameras are, but it's telling me 1920 by 1080.
We're not all like laggy anymore.
Mouths match and everything.
Oh, things are new, right? That's right.
Yeah.
We made some upgrades to the studio.
Yeah. Look at that. Thanks, Mike.
Hey,
technology.
No problem.
Look at this.
Yeah, you can probably see my pores right now. Very clean. One thing that before we forget, because we always forget, if you have anything to tell us, if you want to reach us anyway,
good or bad, really.
Good or bad, whatever. It's up to you. We are on YouTube, obviously, if you're watching us, or you can email us at
flatoutfever@gmail.com, Twitter, flatoutfever, Reddit, flatoutfever.
The links will be at the.
No, we're gonna somewhere
I
down there.
To do that.
Down in the comments.
Yeah, down there.
Down there.
Somewhere. Down there. Oh God. No. No, that looked awful.
And for anyone who's sick of looking at us, even in HD, come on. we're gonna start getting some MP3 links up, and hopefully a website soon.
We went on Reddit the other day on one of the threads, and somebody did say a couple of things, and good points, obviously, always. Yeah. But we have been working on this. We are still working on it. The website will eventually be flatoutfever.com. It's just still not finished.
Yeah.
But it should be finished. I mean, these are all improvements, guys. Don't worry.
Yeah, it takes time. And
I
can understand the not wanting to scroll through 3 hours or whatever.
So. Oh, yeah, but I mean, go for it.
Yeah, we're gonna test out. Well, not test out. We're gonna start making clips. We're gonna divide up the show.
We already did.
We started last week.
Yeah.
And I don't know. That's it.
But yeah,
check out Bamboo if you like that sick bass line that we opened.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Tasty Lex.
Yeah, that's.
I think it's a good. I think it's a good
Bamboo
point. I
mean, music.
Like, the music's fine. The music's it's fun. But we were talking about the direction of the show. I mean, like, we do this because we love doing it, like the process of it.
Right.
And it's probably not going to be as sort of quality comparable to another podcast, say, that's out there. I mean, like, these people have been doing it for years.
Well, we really just started.
Yeah, we just started. So, I mean, you know, it'll take some time before we get to that point of total professionalism.
But we're proving
the early the early crest of the podcast revolution.
Oh yeah, yeah. Riding the just like the wakeboarding. The other part.
We're good. Well, I mean, now we should be in HD. This video shouldn't, you know, if everything goes well, it shouldn't be all laggy like the last episode. We apologize for the lack of quality of the last few episodes. We really have been constrained by the hardware. But now, yeah.
But now things are
tons of stuff to come though. Yeah, for sure. We do have great plans for the rest of the year. Mm-hmm. Tons of stuff, tons of ideas that we want to try out, and we're getting better every time. So bear with us. If you like what we're doing right now, just hang in there. It's only gonna get mm-hmm. better.
And we definitely appreciate everyone yeah. taking the time to watch it. Yeah, don't get us wrong.
Yeah, we'll definitely have everything locked down by Melbourne.
Well, we will try.
Sound like Honda over there.
Yeah.
Oh shit.
Taking stabs.
Oh shit.
Danny over here taking stabs. I don't appreciate that, but no, because
you're boy Alonso.
Yeah, and exactly. Yeah. Well, yeah. Well, we'll get back to Alonso though in a minute, because we also have our fourth round of our win racing for me
RFM invite. Giveaway.
Yes, we've been getting a lot of feedback about that, and again when we when we tried to like post this on or announce that we were doing giveaways on Reddit. I bet
people got upset.
Well, I just
know that
a lot of people. Yeah, exactly. You know
I'm
what
part
I mean?
Of it.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of people just don't know what Racing For Me is.
Oh, okay.
Or really? Racing For Me. It's actually a website. The thing is that because of reasons that become apparent once you find out what Racing For Me is, we can't really go out and say it or like encourage people to go out and like...
Really shouldn't anyways.
Yeah, we really shouldn't. But, and that's why we haven't actually gotten into detail about what Racing For Me is in each episode. But believe me, if you are a fan that is an F1 fan that's... Or really, a motorsport fan in general is tired.
Not
with
just
you.
F1.
Yeah.
Any of them.
Wait, is it? Wait, can we go? Is it because of the legality of it all? Or?
Yeah. Well, oh, no. Okay. Allegedly.
Allegedly.
Yeah.
Right. Allegedly, of course.
Allegedly.
Depends what part of the globe maybe you live on.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Oh, no, I get it.
But either way, it's if North Korea. Correct. If you're in North Korea right now, you probably need Racing For Me.
Wait, if
you'd be an F1 fan.
If you're from North Korea, how are you watching?
Well, I mean, actually, they declared war on the United States yesterday afternoon.
Oh, really?
Oh, get out.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, obviously.
I live under a rock, apparently.
They're full of empty threats, obviously, because you guys didn't even hear about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, this was Kim Jong-un's first big address in 10 or 11 months.
Okay, good
and,
for him.
He requested the entire country be ready for a war. Of any kind.
Of any kind.
With the United States. I guess they need more rice.
Sad. Jesus Christ.
Very sad.
Anyway, onto
the winners.
Yes, the winner.
We'll start with the honorable mention here on Reddit to Waylon, who responded to us. A story about my favorite F1 corner of tracks past and present. Eau Rouge, the end.
That's a story. One sentence.
Sorry, buddy. Somebody beat you.
Of course.
Yeah, I don't know. We had a bunch of entries this week. I don't know how many, but...
Like 14 or 15 or something like that?
Something like that. We're going to give it to Kazumer.
But before we move on to that, Eau Rouge, though, Mike, I mean, you... You will become familiar with this corner because this corner is epic.
It's pretty epic.
Mm-hmm. It is one of my favorite for sure. And when I was starting to get into F1, I did remember people like very early on talking about Eau Rouge is a corner. It's a great corner.
Okay.
It does come up, and it's a great corner. It's in the Belgian Grand Prix.
Okay.
The Belgian Grand Prix is located in a very idyllic location. It's in the middle of the Ardennes Forest. It's the longest track in the calendar.
Yeah.
It's a track that's been there from the very beginnings of F1 pretty much, and it is that corner has been described as being basically like going down a roller coaster if you're driving on an F1 car, because
it's more like going up a roller coaster
I guess so. Yeah, anyway, but nevertheless, we do have a winner.
Kazumer, same as last week. Another YouTube message entry. Here's word for word. Racing4.me contest. Yay. My favorite corner in F1 is the turn 13-14 on Suzuka, aka the spoon curve, for providing both incredible overtakes and epic fuck-ups. Made me a lifetime Kobayashi fan. And if you ever played any sort of racing game, admit it, you have fucked up that curve.
Now, you have, you are quite an avid gamer of the F1 series.
Especially in my teenage years. But Suzuka's in a lot of racing games because it's, as far as Japan goes and worldwide anyways, it's one of the, I don't know, more epic courses.
It's one of the iconic, all-time greats. I'm sure, like,
it's a figure of eight.
It's been around since either the 50s or the 60s. I think it started being raced on in the 60s, like heavily. And obviously, they're Japanese, so there had to have been some level of planning to Suzuka. But I think maybe it wasn't the same kind of planning that goes into modern F1 tracks now with Tilke. It was to do a badass track, and they were bang on.
Might have been better than most of what Tilke's come up with.
Oh, for sure, I think so. Except for maybe America, but
one of the cool things about it too is it being that old, it's actually very safe.
Yeah,
and it came all the way from back then with huge runoffs and whatever.
But it's still a very challenging course, and that corner, just from watching F1, I know that it's a challenging corner. A couple things that I pulled up about Spoon, and when we were, remember when we talked about all the tracks? We're talking about the Japanese Grand Prix track. Mm-hmm. It has a corner that's a spoon, or they call it the spoon corner.
Falls away though, so it sucks you to the outside, and then you want to get out of there super fast though, because you come up to,
well, right after that is 130R, and if
you need to get out of it fast,
yeah, but if you don't clip the corners at the right positions, if you don't take the spoon corner or the spoon curve, if you don't dominate the spoon curve, you're gonna lose some time, because you're gonna lose some time at 130R. It's a big deal. It's a huge corner. I'm glad that Kazuma pointed out. But so a couple things. So in the history of Suzuka being a track, the spoon curve, and it's true. I mean, he even mentions it. You have fucked up that corner. Yes, people have fucked it up. People have fucked it up to their detriment. There have been four fatal crashes.
Yeah, you need to go
since the 60s.
Much slower than it looks like, because it falls away.
Yeah. So some people have lost their lives trying to go around that corner. Four people, more than any other corner in that circuit.
I'm sorry, maybe it's not as safe as I thought it was. I'm sure they got. Probably piled up a few extra tires on the outside since then.
Oh, since then, for sure. But
some Armco barriers.
Even just going back to last year. Gutierrez in a Sauber the free practice too, he crashed there. The year before, who wasn't? I think it was Perez. So his buddy Perez crashed the year before during practice, and going back to 2012 even, Di Resta and Schumacher, they both in different occasions crashed at Spoon during qualifying.
Oh wow!
Yeah, so
I remember that.
Yeah, so Di Resta and Schumacher. I mean, granted, obviously this was Schumacher's second return or something. When he sucked,
kind of caused a few accidents.
Yeah, when he kind of caused a few accidents, he wasn't great. But I mean, but I thought Di Resta back then, you could say that 2013 was probably one of his strongest years, and he crashed at
that guy.
At Spoon. Yeah, I do miss Di Resta as well. So it's not even. Even if you're playing video games, just it is a difficult corner, and it's an enjoyable corner to watch drivers drive by. And I think it also has that feeling of the end of the year, because Suzuka is always, you know, the Japanese Grand Prix is always one of the last few. It's where championships have been decided in the past, many championships. So people are always like excited about Suzuka because it's a great track, because also the championship is ending. You can find out a lot about where people are going to end up at the end of the year there. And all in all, it's no secret that we love Suzuka.
Thanks, Kazuma.
Yeah. Yeah, Kazuma, you're the winner. You'll get your invitation in the mail. In whatever. I'll just reply to your comment on YouTube.
Yeah. Thanks, dude.
Yeah.
You win.
Yay!
Round five.
The final round. Yeah, so when we started this, we announced that we had five invitations to give away. And we're down to the last one. And because it's the last one,
it's not going to be as easy.
Well, Dan had an idea that we're going to extend it until the podcast, whatever podcast we do after the Grand Prix weekend in Melbourne. So after the first race.
Oh, shit.
So that's going to be about, what, 3 weeks, 4 weeks from now?
Yeah, about 3 weeks, I guess.
And Dan, explain.
Basically, well, unless you have some moral reasons and you need to drink water or something, grab a beer, get down to your local racetrack, and let's see you chug it.
Yeah, no, actually,
is that a selfie chug? We just like,
yeah. Well, hopefully you bring somebody or at least like figure out a way to like let it stand, because I've never tried to like selfie chug before, but you have to have the track in sight at least, I would say. So go to a track, go to your local track
if it be a go-kart track.
If you happen to live near an F1 track, it behooves you to go to the F1 track. But if you're
Of course.
Yeah, if you're like us.
Why wouldn't you? Where else would you
in
go?
Toronto?
Do people know that's where we are? I don't think people know that we're living
in Toronto. Oh, yeah, we're in Toronto.
Yeah. Well, but we're on the internet. We're on YouTube.
Yeah, wherever you are. But
I was born on the internet.
But if we wanted to like go to our local racing track, it would be Mossport there. And I guess that's a real racing track.
Maybe a little further.
Either way, I mean, whatever. If there's car racing there, and in the default that you're too far, I suppose go-kart tracks are okay.
Yeah.
but the point is, you got to be at the track. You got to be at the track.
You got to be there.
There. And chugging a beer. Show us in some way or another a picture, a video, whichever way you want to do it. Chug a beer. No, don't chug water. Chug a beer.
Yeah,
a whole beer. No, you can chug water, but no, you know what's going to happen.
Yeah, be a man.
You know what's not going to happen.
Be a man.
Do the beer thing.
Yeah.
So this is the testing podcast, because we just had our second preseason testing of this year.
Yes.
In Barcelona.
Chile, Barcelona.
Yeah, in Barcelona.
So where was the last one?
The last one was in Jerez.
Where?
In Spain.
Oh, okay.
But this is in Barcelona, Spain as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do they all sort of take place near each other?
Last year they did some testing in Bahrain, which they did all the testing in Europe this year to save money.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it's not fully working out because it's been like 5 degrees or something down there. It's been freezing cold. It's winter.
Right.
They're not much further south than us where we are right now.
Hmm.
Yeah, Spain.
There's no snow. It's not snowing or anything.
But it's still
the south of Spain is like pretty much as far south as you get in Europe. But it's still like within the northern hemisphere, quite up there.
Yeah,
it's not in the tropics.
Yeah, exactly. It's I don't know. It's not typical of a race weekend. For basically, they're all hot. Almost every single race is hot.
Right
throughout the year.
And the coldest that it gets sometimes for like in the typical calendar, I think over the past few years, it's been like Spa. Germany. Yeah. Yeah, Germany or Spa. And Spa's still like down to 15 degrees, not 4 or 5.
Silverstone too, maybe.
Yeah.
It's in England, so it's probably going to be raining and overcast.
Raining in England? No.
No.
Yeah, even though it's the summer, you know.
So, testing, day one. I want to get right into this because we've got a lot to talk about. A lot was announced and done during testing. Obviously, we haven't forgotten. What should we get to the Alonso stuff first?
Let's talk about Alonso. That's the biggest news.
Go for it. Begin.
Well, okay, we'll go to the next tab here. We'll look at start off with the diagram.
So what happened? Because there's a lot of people that are saying a lot of different things. And a lot of it just sounds like, I mean, it sounds like the stuff that I would say, like, to make excuses for. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I don't know. Mercedes, they seem kind of, McLaren seem kind of
on the fence,
wishy-washy about what they want to say in the media about this. So this picture was... don't know. It sort of explains what happened, but there's, I don't know. There's actually a video there too.
The actual photographs that we see there, those are those are taken by that that photographer, and it is clearly that this is taken from some sort of Spanish publication or something. We took it from Reddit, just as a courtesy of Reddit, because they didn't say where this was from. But either way, so those pictures at the front, those are the only pictures of from that angle. So based on these pictures, this guy put together this simulation. So the line in red here that you see, that's the normal racing line.
Okay.
That's what you would take to approach this corner. Now, the thing is that during a normal, like if you're going around a circuit like this, you're going in that direction, you see the racing line here in red. If you're going to fuck that racing line up, then most people, like what would happen during, like if you fuck it up, you normally expect to see a driver go like down here. You know, not on the inside.
Right.
And that's the number one thing that was puzzling about this accident.
Well, here's the thing. Let's look at quickly the Pastor Maldonado link right there. We can't show it though.
Oh,
okay. We can. Well, let's watch it.
I know. I got to switch my.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
We're going to watch it and describe it to you because of copyright law.
Well, just say what it was.
Basically last year, Maldonado came around the same corner and almost identically crashed.
Yeah,
into the same corner. So, yeah, let's watch this quickly. So here you see him.
He's going around. He loses control. Then it all goes really, really, really bad for him when he steps on a piece of AstroTurf.
He lost control on turn one.
There he goes.
He hits the fake grass. He goes behind the hill. But here, look. The second corner, he's losing control.
Already?
Can't get the grip back and goes straight to the outside and touch the AstroTurf.
See, this is AstroTurf. As soon as he's done that,
watch his hands.
Too much power.
Look at the force of that, though. He's using two hands to hold the steering wheel locked left. Almost identical to what Alonso did yesterday.
Yeah, so on the inside, as a consequence of maybe going, stepping on the AstroTurf a bit too much. Let's go back to this picture.
Seems like maybe they should pull the AstroTurf out of there, but really, like where that white line is kind of like to the bottom left of the picture there, that's basically where you're supposed to be coming out of the corner. But I don't know. There's a lot of because of the weather, the winter weather, it was crazy windy there.
Yeah, it was the windiest day.
One of McLaren's excuses that the wind blew him into the wall.
Now here's what I think, and it actually happened. I think it was something very similar to that Maldonado crash. But it has to do with the way that the McLaren was delivering that power. A McLaren or the Honda engine, more like it, was delivering the power. I think that Alonso was trying to take it easy around this corner because he felt the action of the wind or something happened like that, and he was trying to take it easy around this corner, and then something happened and the power just kicked in when he was on the AstroTurf, and he lost control because there's no way that he would have hit there and there after being on the racing line if he hadn't lost control of the car. Like, this was, you know what I mean? Like, it just doesn't make sense that if it was something else, like say, like if your steering column breaks, like if you're just can't turn and the car is like turning any like somewhere else that you want it to, what you would expect from that is for it to go and run wider, right? Because it would just keep going in the direction, right? Or, but just not this. This means, like, this to me says he lost control. Now, Toby Gruner, right here.
That was one of the other conspiracy theories, was that there was some sort of a curse dump by accident, or that he got electrocuted and was unconscious when the accident happened.
Well, that's the thing. Yes. Some people are saying that.
So many wild theories about it.
That maybe he fainted.
He could have fainted from the G-force. Could be the wind. Could be a curse dump. Could be electrocution.
We don't know yet.
Could be a lie.
Could be the grass.
Could be a blatant lie. The thing is that we haven't heard from Alonso himself. All we've heard about, the only thing that McLaren have confirmed,
is that he got into an accident?
is that he got into an accident, exactly. And that he's okay.
Okay. Yeah.
He seems to be okay. They've run an MRIs, CT scan. A CT scan and MRI came back saying that he's perfectly fine.
Normal.
But
he did smash the wallet absorb 30 Gs.
30 Gs
through his body. So, and
oh my god!
The first, yeah, when he first
he did have a concussion. So
yeah, he got a concussion during the crash, though, not before the crash. So during the crash, because right. I mean, 30 Gs. So that means that at one point your head becomes 30 times heavier than it is, and it just like pulls and gets banged up. 30 Gs is a lot. I mean, yeah. The more that you see these cars pull around the corner, even like when they're going fast, it's like what, like 4, 5, 6 Gs tops.
Yeah. Well, Gio Bianchi absorbed, it was like 49 or something like that, 48 or 49 last year.
And he's still in a coma. So 30 Gs is a lot. And they said that the car actually looks surprisingly well for having absorbed 30 Gs.
Yeah.
So what they're saying is that like maybe Alonso was the one that absorbed most
of it.
Yeah, most of that energy. And you got to think about it. Like even in pure physical terms, if he's going at that speed and he's crashing, and they come into a dead stop, and the car doesn't deform, doesn't break away, and there's 30 Gs there that were recorded in the sensor, and that all goes through your body, it does something to you.
Mm-hmm.
It like it fucks you up in ways.
Rattles that, you, man.
Yeah, man. Exactly.
Your brain is flying.
And they're even saying that Alonso might not even make it to the second test of in Barcelona. So that's the test that's coming up later this week, starting Thursday, because of this.
He himself tweeted something like, his team has one of the best drivers in the wind tunnel. I think he meant in the simulator, but
oh.
Suggesting he might be there for testing next week. I don't know.
Pedro de la Rosa. Oh, wait, no, shit.
Magnussen, right?
Yeah, Magnussen. That's true. Magnussen. Yeah.
He tweeted that he's been in the wind tunnel, but yeah. He is one of the more competitive drivers.
That is true. Yeah, he did a great job last year.
Well, the more competitive ones that work for McLaren.
I find this thing that Vettel said. I don't think it would benefit Vettel in any way or another to like lie or make this up. No. I think that this is genuine. That he was going. Obviously, I mean, he says his speed was slow.
Yeah. Maybe only 150.
Yeah, only 150 around that corner. Yeah. That's still a lot. See, he's still going fast, but he's going slow for an F1 car.
And it is probably one of the faster corners in the season too.
Yeah. We'll see.
We'll find out.
We'll wait to see what happened to Alonso, really.
Check out that next tweet, because the night of the accident, these pictures came up.
Oh, show
the skid mark that he left.
So he was trying to break.
Yeah. But it's kind of weird. It looks like only the inside tire was breaking.
Oh, yeah. That's only...
You
know what
I mean? You can sort of see, like, on the right picture especially, it's a bit lighter. You can see, like, maybe a scrape mark. You can see where the tire bumped over the inside curb. See the top side?
Oh, yeah, this one?
Yeah, that's the other tire.
Ah.
But leading up to it, only the inside tire was locked. So.
Yeah. Only that one tire.
And turning... Huh. I think turning left, probably your outside tire should be heavier, right? I don't know. It's kind of weird. Maybe like that locked tire would pull you into the wall.
We don't know what happened here. It's all very mysterious.
Yeah.
Move over to that next video, because
you know
I
what?
Think this
I
is
love,
the best.
I love mystery. That is. Can we show this?
Yeah.
Flash has crashed.
That's fine.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, this
I think
is somebody.
This is the best maybe explanation I think of what happened. Somebody in the audience here recorded this. You can see him going fast as hell around the first two corners.
Yeah. So it's not like he's going super
fast. Disappeared to the top of the hill. With a video game here.
This is great. So
probably giving up his flying lap, Alonso starts to decelerate around to 150 kilometers an hour.
So questions have to be asked. Why
touches the grass. According to McLaren, Alonso picked up the extra turf on turn 3 exit, and that's where his problems begin. Oversteered, slid into the wall. Car's pointing forwards toward the barrier with a big angle, but then McLaren straightens just before crashing into the wall while he's on the grass. The impact is nearly sideways on the bare wall. The suspension remains intact, even though bent. So a great part of the energy is dissipated directly through Alonso's body. 30 G impact is a lot. And he bounced multiple times on the wall before stopping and the second 15G impact is recorded before now, the car fully stops.
Toby of AMUS, he's also said that this is the one that actually like fucked him up most because it was a sustained 15G. It wasn't a like
boom. Instantaneous.
No, it was a sustained. We're talking about milliseconds, like 54 milliseconds, but still, that's the one that does the damage. I'm glad people have taken the time to do this.
This is amazing.
Yeah.
This is blowing my mind.
Yeah, somebody broke it down.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Thank you.
Ooh, look at all these angles.
Yeah.
Seems pretty accurate. You still can't tell like, what happened to the car.
Yeah.
I think only Honda knows for sure.
Honda's gonna Honda and McLaren are gonna have to like release.
They're gonna need to make a statement.
Yeah, this because I guess
they're waiting for Alonso. He must be home by now this afternoon.
Man,
what's his buddy's name here? Said Alonso doesn't remember even what happened. I forget the dude's name.
That was Briatore, wasn't it?
Yeah, Briatore. But yeah, I guess he must have spoken to Alonso.
Well, okay, YouTube's autoplays.
Oh, yeah. Uncheck that box in the top right.
This one?
Bullshit. Yeah, they added that like a week ago.
Bastards.
Feed you more advertising. Briatore, I guess Alonso's buddy. Who is this dude?
Well, okay, Briatore, Flavio Briatore was the team boss for the old Renault team back when Alonso won his titles in 2005-2006. And further than that, he became, in a way, Alonso's manager. But yeah, they have been friends since then. Now, Briatore got kicked out of F1 and told never to come back because when he was a team principal at this Renault team, he basically told Alonso's teammate to crash purposely. And this was like on the, like, everybody could hear it.
Oh my God.
He was like, you're gonna turn, and after this turn you're gonna crash so that Alonso could win.
the famous crash gate.
Yeah,
Jesus crash Christ gate.
And as a consequence of that, this dude, this Briatore guy, was told not to ever come back to Formula One ever again.
Jesus, wonder why.
He must have visited Alonso in hospital. Well, can you throw up the link I just sent you?
They're actually good friends, or from what we understand, they are actually friends, this Briatore guy. But that's all we know
from back in that day. Here's a photo. Alyssa Alonso's second really serious accident in his career. This is not from the other day. This is, he's wearing his Renault uniform. That was the last time he was taken away in a stretcher.
Damn.
We don't even have pictures of that because...
they had a blanket.
They had like some sort of a blanket covering it. They just didn't want people to see the way he was.
That's heavy.
And also because the testing is in Barcelona and Alonso is Spanish. So they didn't even release in the beginning. The first day they didn't release the name of the hospital he was in because they were afraid that too many fans were going to flock it. Not let the poor guy rest. But for what we understand and what we've seen on social media and whatever else, he's like posted pictures of like, with thumbs up.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently the CT scan and MRI are good. So
he's joking about his teammate taking over for him. It's very, very
somehow sudden. He's in good condition, but we'll see because he might not be there at the end of this week when the second testing starts to happen. Now
he definitely needs to be because it's Honda engine.
Yeah.
Oh shit.
he said in an interview that this year he loves testing. I love testing. And if Melbourne was in June, July, it would be better, but it's not.
Yeah. I guess he's going to get to do some testing into the season.
I guess so.
It seems that way.
Because and this is weird because we're seeing this Honda engine, another talking point throughout the testing session, and I guess we'll get to that is how this Honda engine started to fail from the first day. So let's get into the first day. What happened? So Barcelona, second test day, the first day it was fine, like weather wise so everybody started their normal practice, except let's touch on one thing. Except Mercedes, when Hamilton showed up, he showed up, he did some laps or a lap or something, and then he said he decided he was sick.
He did a bunch, but yeah, he said he had a fever and he wasn't feeling it.
Yeah,
he seemed a little stuffed up.
Yeah, yeah. I think he did have a fever. And he
flat out fever.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, to go home and listen to our podcast. Yeah.
But the thing,
those guys from Toronto, I just can't get enough of them.
But here's what happened. Because he had a fever, okay, so the logical progression is that if the driver that's scheduled to drive the car that day is for some reason not available, then they call the second driver.
Yeah.
And the second driver, or the other driver, let's say, in this case is Nico Rosberg. But Nico Rosberg had been complaining that the car had pinched one of his nerves or something about the way that the seating position that they had for this year's car was screwing up his neck. So he refused to go in the car too.
Maybe it was his new breathing technique.
Breathe through the corners. So they pulled this kid called Pascal Wehrlein. This German kid that looks not German.
Pascal, he looks half Spanish
or with French the German or something. Names, yeah. So they pulled him off this Force India team that Force India isn't testing. Force India wasn't there for the last testing,
right?
And was the only team pretty much that didn't make it there, or with the exception of Marussia or Manor. But anyway, Force India was there now, running the 2014 car. So they didn't even show up with this year's car. Mm-hmm. They showed up with a 2014 car, and I guess the thing was that Mercedes was paying them so that this kid Pascal Wehrlein could have enough track time.
It's a prospect for them.
Yeah,
for their team.
Jesus.
But instead of doing that, he then had to like jump out of the Force India car and then go to Mercedes because the two Mercedes drivers didn't want to drive. And that's as a driver that's in the testing phases, and as a guy that's not an F1, but his prospects are in F1. That's pretty much the best thing that could have happened.
You got to drive two different cars for two different teams in one day.
Two cars from two different years.
Two different years,
even. The championship contender car.
Yeah. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah, and he did quite a few laps.
And they had to call Checo from home to come finish up the day for them, Force India.
That's true, yeah. But what is this testing, right? So a few weeks ago, we had the first testing in Jerez. Mm-hmm. And that testing was, because it was the first testing of the preseason, people were trying to figure out different things. It was all about just ironing out the details, like, you know, like anything that could have come up with like the bolting the engine to the car, things like that, minor things.
Mapping out vibration.
Yeah. That's what you were expected to iron out at Jerez. No real significant stuff, because you don't, like, these cars are not racing at Jerez at any point of the year.
They don't race there, and it's a really old track.
It's an outdated track, but it's good enough for F1, but it's outdated, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, you weren't meant to get any representative times or anything like that.
Right.
But even then, Mercedes went and destroyed everyone, because
Ferrari got, and Sauber.
Yeah, the Ferrari engines were pretty good there. But now
I think that was sandbagging.
Now we're in Barcelona, second preseason test, and this one, the times that we're seeing here start to be a little more significant, because this is a proper F1 racing track. They will come back here by the time the Spanish Grand Prix is. Is it going to be at the same track? Albeit different temperatures, I'm sure.
Right.
one would expect. So this test matters, and in this test, now that they've ironed out the smaller details in Jerez, they're gonna try to actually start going into longer distances, doing the long runs, doing race simulations. Not necessarily, some teams clearly haven't opted for doing fast laps, but at least you want to get reliability. You want to make sure you are reliable, and teams are looking to try to find out if they're reliable or not by doing just long runs.
Mm-hmm. See, what's interesting is Hamilton and Rosberg being sick and going home. They have the fourth and fifth most laps for the whole week of testing. And Ricciardo beat Hamilton only by one lap, 201 and 202. And Rosberg did 197. So the two of them were sick and injured. And then you look back at, like, McLaren did 45 and obviously Alonso didn't do too many.
One thing that I do want to point out, and it's not that, because let's go back to last year. And last year when they did these testing all throughout the three preseason testings or however many there were last year, teams like, well, Red Bull didn't look competitive at all, right?
They were barely ready.
Yeah, they barely had any laps in.
Barely ready in time for the race.
But then during the year, they came and actually became basically the best of the rest. Yeah. They won three races, right? So
well, Ricciardo did anyways.
Yeah, exactly. I think even Ferrari looked good last year during testing, and then they went to do absolutely nothing. So
this is a big thing I want to talk about today is Renault, and yeah, how all that. Okay,
let's talk about
testing first.
Yeah, it's exactly. So we're in a position that testing right now is maybe not representative about anything at all. But I
same story as every other year.
Of course, yeah, as every other year. But I think that there is something that we can take definitively from this testing session right now, or from this first Barcelona test, and it's that these cars this year are faster than last year.
They are.
And they're faster by some may say that by a lot. So let's say, okay, so last year, and I looked this up,
the pole time?
Yeah, the pole position time of Lewis Hamilton on the 2014 Spanish Grand Prix qualifying session.
I watched this video last night, but I don't remember the time.
Well, it was 1:25.232. So who's faster than that? I think we have at least... what, like four or five?
From more than half the drivers were faster, and including Rosberg on the medium tires.
That's
smashed it. 1:24.3 on the medium.
That's ridiculous, man. I don't know.
I think they race here on the medium and soft. So yeah, it is crazy.
I don't know when the last time that this happened was, but it must have been somewhere like, you know, one year where they changed from, like, say, you know, V6 to V10. I don't know, a year where but this is dramatic.
I think it was the same year they switched the V8 to V10 or V10 to V8. Sorry, which back then I think they would have been going much faster. But that was the same year that they added that last chicane.
It's right. Like
a whole new course. They keep calling it the new chicane, but I think they built it in 2006.
We can stop calling it new.
Yeah, well, I guess whatever. Shows how old the course is though.
I wanna drive attention back to this because this is okay. So this
is it's amazing.
This
it's
is
awesome. We'll see next week.
A Mercedes.
Next week I would assume every team's gonna beat it.
But this was a Mercedes driven by Lewis Hamilton, arguably the fastest driver on the grid.
All the knobs are turned up to 11 at the time.
At qualifying, obviously. Yeah. They were probably running at that point during Q3, low fuel.
Yeah, of course.
And
the big
softer tires.
The big talk is that they've been running with nothing but full gas tank.
And also Mercedes. The Mercedes times that they did right now in this test. What's the highest Mercedes time there? Is it?
It's Rosberg was second overall, 1:24. Well, actually, Grosjean and the Lotus, powered by Mercedes, beat him by about less than a third of a second. But he was on the super soft. With with Rosberg on the medium.
So exactly, that's what I'm
that's
saying.
That's the biggest.
That's what I'm saying. And the thing about these, I'm glad that you mentioned the super softs that Grosjean was running. And the thing about those super softs is that
Lotus ran all super soft for both their times.
Yeah, so he got faster. And Grosjean, you know, all credit to him. He is, when he's out on the track by himself, he is a fast driver. But he was on these super soft tires that are basically the only tires that are completely different from last year. Now, all the tires that they have, all the different specs of the tires have changed. But the only one that has changed the compound and everything about it is the super soft. So and it's supposed to be grippier this year. So with a grippy tire, Grosjean managed to go faster than Rosberg. But Rosberg has the mediums. So we're talking about this Mercedes is gonna destroy everyone. What we're seeing right now.
Next week, I think I would say almost every team will smash these times again next week because the chance of the weather being unusually cold 2 weeks in a row is low.
Yeah.
And then they're all going to be, especially on the last 2 days anyway, they're going to They're going to see, like, what can this thing do before we get to Australia, right?
Exactly, exactly.
Everybody
and,
will.
And during testing in Australia, I'm sure we'll have more talking points about that. But yeah, well,
then we'll
I
see for real.
I think that, when I read that, and when I found that out, that these year's cars are so drastically faster. But
yeah, it's awesome, man.
My jaw was on the floor, and I am so excited to see them go around the tracks because it's going to be amazing.
Yeah, it's going to be great.
Yeah.
Well, whatever. There's more teams on the Mercedes power anyways, so at least there should be a closer competition, at least in the middle.
And Ferrari's actually looking pretty good. Some people are saying now that maybe Ferrari, we're talking about Ferrari, Williams, and Lotus are looking somewhere like around the same level.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. They're all using such different strategies.
It's all very hard to read right now, but we can definitely read into that. Those are numbers that don't lie. Half the field is faster than the fastest time around this track on a qualifying situation.
In hot weather.
Ooh. So like these cars are definitely faster than last year's cars. That's a fact.
Yeah.
Telling it like it is.
Yeah. Here. Bro. God,
that's the way it is. By the end of the year last year, last year's cars were beating the V8s on some tracks, certain tracks.
Well, I mean, but we're talking about like with the addition of the turbos.
Yeah.
Of course they were going to be faster in Brazil because it's how the higher elevation. Yeah, right? Okay. But this is you can't dispute that.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah, it's gonna be good. What else happened during the first day? What happened during the first day? So yeah, Lewis had the fever. Raikkonen did about 70 laps, proving that the Ferrari, if anything, is reliable. Yeah. What else?
It's like a race and a half for him.
Felipe Nasser and Wolff had a crash.
Oh yeah,
that
they blamed on each other.
They blamed on each other, and then the chick, Susie Wolf, said that it was a stupid crash. And you know what? Yeah. I believe it because Nasser kid doesn't seem that strong, to be honest.
Well, he admitted himself that he like dive bombed her. He tried to outbreak her into the corner, mm-hmm. came up behind, and she didn't see him. Just kind of went over each other's wheels.
Yeah.
No, she said she went over and yelled at him, but whatever. There's no, no video. Somebody had, I think, a cell phone video that I heard, but.
And this is something that I've complained about before.
You'll never get to see that.
When we were talking about this case, and I think this is stupid that FOM doesn't record these testing sessions. Like,
yeah, come on. Put them on.
It seems kind of silly that they don't. It's. I guess you do have to pay people for that to come out too, right?
Yeah, and I guess right now in the old way of doing television, this wouldn't have made much sense because in with pay TV and like cable subscriptions or whatever, like we're talking about testing sessions that last pretty much all day, mm-hmm. and to broadcast that, you know, to pay somebody times, but.
Dude, just fucking
haven't I said it? I have the solution. Just put a couple of fucking automatic cameras.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just people don't need to have like the best quality.
Holy
just
shit.
Put a couple
you know
of webcams.
How easy that would be.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would have that in the background in my living room.
Stream it online. Even if you just offer it for free, the testing, that can only help you. That can only bring more people to F1.
It's marketing. Yeah. I'm gonna keep on comparing this to fighting because they do a whole.
Yeah.
Well, sort of with, I don't know, hopefully they'll take some of these suggestions this year and do more, like do the conference in the city like they do there.
Arriva bene.
Yeah, they call it the fight week. They should be a race week in each city where you have like a meet and greet with the drivers. Like the fighters just come out. People come, they just wave.
You gotta get hype, man.
I'm not sure I would go to that, but people would go to that.
Yeah.
But for sure, this is practice. The cameraman must need practice. They're rusty from last year. Set them up around the track.
Yeah.
They practice their panning and whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. Panning and zooming.
It's silly that they don't. And because they don't, we as spectators and people that are, you know, trying to put podcasts together are missing out on some vital information.
Yeah, people want to know this shit.
People want to know this.
It's like preseason games. I would think. Yeah. Like people would watch them if they were like shown
easily
a bit more.
Available.
I mean like they still show them, but I mean like
if they were easily available.
Sure. Yeah. No, that's true.
Yeah, it works the same.
More or less the attention that they sort of should get, because there has been
it's the same for hockey, right?
Summer, right?
Again, I don't know anything about hockey. But if you want to, I'm sure if you go online exactly like this, you can read stories about what happened in the preseason games.
Oh, totally.
Who did what?
Yeah, and
who's
are they looking?
Who's looking strong and whatever?
Yeah, totally. And there's like a good few weeks of that too. Like, it's not...
Come on, guys, get on this.
Yeah, seriously.
MMA is the fastest growing sport in the world.
Is it really? That's crazy.
It has been for a few years, but it's got to be a lot to do with their social media and marketing department.
Or Joe Rogan.
Or Joe Rogan.
He only does maybe half the commentary nowadays.
Right.
But I don't think he likes traveling too much. But he's basically the Martin Brundle is the Joe Rogan of F1.
Oh, shit.
We showed the tweet before.
Yeah.
He knows his shit and remembers everything.
Everything. Every stat.
Yeah. But anyway, guys, you know how I usually bring us some beer this time, or something interesting to drink.
Yep.
Sometimes it's related to where the F1 event is happening.
Brewed from the fields around the race.
Well, yeah, this is
Catalunya.
This is Estrella Damm, and it's a beer that is from Barcelona. Danny, for the last time, damn, it's Barcelona, if you want to pronounce it. No, Barcelona. It's not Italian.
It's not Italian.
Barcelona. That sounded real.
No, but you know how sometimes like you find stuff at the LCBO that like pretends to be from another country,
right?
You know,
Sapporo.
And like for some, exactly, or you know, Guinness or whatever. And then you go if you go to Dublin, like you'll find that most people don't actually drink Guinness.
Yeah.
People actually do drink Estrella in Spain.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
Yeah, it's not bad. It's kind of like a summer beer, but
I was just gonna say very crisp.
Mm. I like that. These are my sort of beers.
Yeah, boring beer. Okay.
Yeah. No, I'm not saying it's exciting, man. But if I have another bone shaker, it's literally gonna.
It will shake your bones.
Shake my bones.
That's the whole point.
Red Bull is still having issues.
Yeah.
With and I wanna expand a lot on their issues later, but from day one of this second test, Red Bull still issues.
They're saying that their engine, Renault's engine, is more powerful than last year, but that it's kind of sporadic.
That's what you want in your F1 engines, sporadic drop of power.
Yeah, they're saying it's affecting drivability, and they're going to attempt to correct it with software. Which is
science.
Software, yeah.
Let's talk about that right now, because so what I heard that Renault have been saying, or the official, one of the official statements is
Renault business.
Yeah, let's get into it. They said that throughout the winter, because they did so poorly, so badly last year, mm-hmm. like their engines were basically the worst of the field, even worse than the really bad Ferraris.
Somehow Ricciardo pulled off 3 wins, though.
But that was thanks to like the aerodynamics of the car, largely.
Well, and Mercedes' failure in Canada.
Exactly.
Whatever else.
Either way, these Renault engines were no good. And because of that, they've actually lost another customer team. Now their only two customer teams is basically Red Bull and Toro Rosso,
and
which
Toro Rosso.
Is owned by Red Bull.
Which is Red Bull.
So only the Red Bulls are running Renault engines, and they said that throughout the winter, they tried to focus on reliability. They tried to iron out the reliability problems of the Renault engines, and somehow they said that they figured it out, and I guess they have, because when they have gone out, they have gone out for way longer than they went out last year during testing.
Yeah,
right. So
yeah, they've been getting the laps in.
They're beginning
just not the times
the laps. Yeah, so now they're saying that the problem is not necessarily reliability anymore, but drivability.
Yeah.
Now you can probably that just seems like one of those terms that like people that are like heavy into PR use, or one of those sentences that people like, oh, it rhymes, so like we can spin this, like
we can sell it.
Yeah. It's not reliability, it's drivability. You can blanket many things under drivability.
Right.
Like the power delivery of the engine. And now they're saying
I think that's the problem, is that I think the turbo causes probably a big kick when it spools up, and that's
Yeah, well, and that's what they're saying. They said that, really, I mean, some people have dissected this and have said that probably what's happened is that before this, like before right now, throughout the winter, they've been working on the electric part of the motor, like the whole harvesting system and the electric harness. Recovery. Yeah. And now they're just realizing, like, oh shit, we also should have worked on the combustion engine part of it.
So this is. I think Renault has bigger problems than even that.
Yeah.
Well, which spin off of that, that they've been talking this week about buying into another team for a works team again.
Oh, yeah.
They had some success back in the day, but let's... anyway, like a week ago, there was a story. We kind of skipped over it because whatever, it didn't seem like anything, but now it seems more important. Renault saying they could postpone their F1 engine development push to help 2016, like they're thinking about saving a bunch of their tokens.
We're token hoarding here now.
Yeah, basically, like,
these tokens. I don't know what they are still, but I want them.
Basically, Renault wants all of them.
The thought was that basically Ferrari, McLaren, and Renault would be using as many tokens as they could before Australia.
That's what the FIA wants.
That's what they want, but. Yeah. The thought was that they would do it strategically because Honda is going to be getting for the season the average of the unused tokens that they use. But Renault's talking about postponing a lot of their development until later in the season to sort of double up on next year. They're going to be getting another chunk of tokens, I think 25.
Right.
And the more they save from this year towards whatever, the last two races, they can push their upgrades till then and sort of get a bigger combinatory effect. But now the news is coming out now where Renault themselves, it was a big rumor before, but Renault themselves are saying that they're looking probably to buy into a team to create another works team.
A works team, like in F1 speak, a works team means like, for example, Ferrari is the works team of the Ferrari engine because the team itself is Ferrari and the engine that the car has is a Ferrari. So gotcha. So you got gotcha. the works Mercedes team is the Mercedes that has a Mercedes engine. Right. For example,
can you throw up the tweet I just sent you? This is again from Gruner. But yeah, they're looking into basically. Probably Force India, Lotus, Sauber, or Toro Rosso. The thing is, they lost a lot of customers this year, half their customers.
Yeah.
Even more, really, because Red Bull and Toro Rosso are the same team. And Renault is really an F1 for advertising.
Yes, they want to sell more cars.
They want to sell more cars. They want their engine to be badass so they could sell more cars.
But listen, Danny, okay, we talk about, you know...
my point was that they're now relying on Red Bull to win to prove that their engine is doing well. Whereas if they have their own team, they can at least double their chances. And this goes on top of what I thought were weak rumors, but maybe not, that Red Bull might be looking to Caterham... to build them a new engine branded as a Red Bull.
Oh,
because they're so fed up with this performance, right? They were winning. Yeah. They went from four-time consecutive world champion to not doing too well, right?
Not doing too well. That last year, they didn't do too well.
All these rumors start to make sense when you put them together.
And even,
I would guess that this will happen.
Even more, man. Because I looked into that kind of... I looked into this. I looked into the whole Renault thing. To go back a few podcasts ago when we talked about the tokens. So the tokens is, you remember, so each engine, each power unit, as we call it, each part of the power unit has a number of tokens assigned to it, and they're only allowed to modify this and this and that, and they have a number of tokens that if they don't use, they can use it later throughout the year because of the homologation thing. And if they don't use it this year, then they get to use it the next year, blah, 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 blah. Right? There's a whole... But at that point, the speculation was that because the FIA came with a solution that to avoid the problems with the loophole, we're going to say that whatever tokens you don't use by the time that the first race starts, then Honda gets the average of all of those, right? So to some teams, if some teams were... or if some engine manufacturers were presumably thinking that Honda was going to be a threat, what you would be wanting to do is use as many of those tokens before that first race, homologate the engine then,
right?
To not so that Honda didn't have that much to play with, right? Whoa. You know, you're greedy and you're evil and whatever, sure, right? You do that. Yeah. And then, yeah. but now Renault
prize money.
Well, now Renault has
it's all
been
about that prize money
has been saying that no, they're actually gonna hoard all of their tokens or as much as they can,
as many as they can afford.
Yeah, as many as they can afford to hoard. And then go the entire year without even using them that much, so they can use it next year, all of them together with the other bunch of engines or tokens.
Could even mean 1 year of almost self-sabotage.
Yeah.
Because they might be convinced that Red Bull is going that way, either to Caterham or whoever, maybe Ferrari or Mercedes, and they're like, oh, fuck, we better stop developing this engine now. Double down, so next year we can show them that they should have stayed, right?
Yeah, but I mean, I think Renault would be silly. Number one, it would be silly to think that way because Red Bull has been very, very good to Renault. They've stuck, they've stuck with them. They have a good relationship. They've, Renault is basically a sister company of Nissan.
But they've been talking shit.
I know. And through their Nissan partnership, that's why they have the Infiniti, sponsorship,
which is ending this year, I think. Right?
I don't know. I'm not sure about that.
I think it is.
But anyway, it came out. The numbers came out last year that
not this year at the end of this year
oh okay well either way the numbers came out last year that sponsorship, the Infiniti sponsorship of Red Bull, had generated over $1 billion worth of like advertising money, like it made sense, it was the first time that any company made it broke $1 billion of benefit from the Red Bull, right?
Hey, where'd you get those Vettel gloves?
One day we'll make a contest with those, but anyway. So yeah,
I'm entering.
Before, they had a good partnership. Everything was good. Now it's going down, and we're talking about a year that maybe, like you said, Red Bull is gonna have to sit out and not be as competitive as they would want to.
They might not have a choice.
But
I
think
Renault's saving their.
You know what I think is? I looked
saving aces up their sleeve. Right?
Well, like I said, no, their aces up their sleeve. I think is this that I looked I looked up.
They can spend all year in the background developing and keep the tokens in their pocket. Develop all kinds of stuff,
but develop with who, right? And
for themselves.
Well, but that's what becomes kind of interesting because, and I remember watching this on Ted's Notebook, and he mentioned something just very briefly. He said that they're bringing this guy called Mario Illion, in to help out the Renault engine developers. Now I looked up into this Mario Illion guy. He is a Swiss engineer. He is a principal at Aylmore Engineering. Now they worked together with Mercedes back in the 90s when Mercedes was the engine supplier, I think only solely to McLaren. So it was the old McLaren Mercedes that were very dominant. I think they won two championships with Mika Hakkinen back then. That's when they released that car, the McLaren F1 car. You know what I mean? Like that back then.
Back
so
the V10 days.
Yeah. So Mario Illion, he's from back old school. Now what he does right now is I think he's his company does IndyCar and MotoGP engines. They have they tune them, or like they offer engineering advice or engineering consultancy to those firms. But either way, he's some sort of engine guru, and they wanna bring him in. To at least work together with the Renault guys or coach him or somehow. But this is a recent thing. This only recently came out. And you don't build an engine, like you don't revolutionize an engine. And this is what Renault is going to have to do. Renault is going to have to scrap whatever their engine plans are right now and basically come up with an entirely different solution if they want to be up there with Mercedes. And they're bringing this guy to maybe try to help them do that, but that's not going to happen overnight. Now, they probably sprung these news on Red Bull recently, and that's why when you see Christian Horner right now, Christian Horner is a team principal at Red Bull, when he's been giving interviews right now during testing, he doesn't look too happy because his cars are not reliable. and I think that's going to – I think this makes sense, and I think this is going to continue for the rest of the year. Red Bull not being competitive, and in that light, Yeah. I guess it makes sense that they don't have right now too much of an experienced roster of lineup of drivers. You know what I mean? Like so we have the junior team with the junior drivers.
This is why I'm almost convinced this is happening. Yeah. Renault's going to have a customer team. They're relying fully on Red Bull, who's talking shit, who has baby drivers.
Yeah.
They won 3 races last year, and they're hoarding. I think they're purposely hoarding these tokens to double down on their success next year. They seem incredibly optimistic. This dude, Cyril Abiteboul, who's Renault's F1 managing director. Mm-hmm. I'm going to read a quote completely out of context, but he just says, yeah, the world is full of options. The future is unknown. The future is to be written. So... that, I think expect them next year. Yeah.
For now, I think we'll hopefully, see. I mean, we'll see what happens, but
we'll see. I would expect it personally. I'm not French or anything, but you know, their situation's not looking good unless they do this.
The McLaren seal.
What was that?
That was my best impression of a seal.
You know, okay.
Got a few seal problems.
Yeah. So McLaren Honda, they have a brand new engine that's been brought to the sport, here's the thing, they're having problems, but we knew that they were gonna have problems, and we knew that their problems were gonna be of the electrical variety most of the time, because they basically announced that the last testing session. They said, we know the areas that we gotta work on, and we are going to be testing specifically for those. So now the McLaren arrived day one, boom, having a problem with a seal. this is actually like I'm sure it's like a seal, like an actual seal,
or like seal's the thing. Picture of seal, like a kiss from the rose on the grave. Just like it goes like that.
Yeah. So this seal, and it has something to do with the MGUK, the KERS system. Now KERS is in F1 they call it now MGUK or KERS, and it's what recovers electrical energy from the braking. So when the drivers apply the brake, there's this mechanism that takes that force and somehow takes part of it and stores it electrically.
Right.
How they do it, it's a mystery to me.
That's fucking magic as far as I'm concerned.
It's like the motor generator unit dash KERS.
Yeah, exactly. That's what it stands for, MGU-K. something with the electronics.
Right.
And like I said, we knew from Yasuhisha Arai telling us.
I was like, I have to really get into the moment.
For Yasuhisha Arai, he told us before, he told the world at large that Honda were having electrical problems, and they know that, but now this thing seems to, this seal came up and sort of surprised them, because they weren't expecting that part to go wrong, and they weren't expecting that one. And I think somebody of McLaren Honda or Honda or McLaren was quoted saying something like, "Oh, it's such a stupid part. Like, why did that one have to go wrong? You know, because the rest they could have fixed probably.
They were trying to re-engineer it during the week, right? But
well."
These two guys' lap numbers.
No. Here, let me, because this is another one of those like PR like phrases that they probably like, somebody probably like spent some hours thinking about this. But no, what they had to do first, and when they said that they had to do first, is redesign the seal. And then when they brought it, the redesign the seal, wouldn't get to them until Saturday, which was the fourth day of testing. The third day of testing.
Yeah.
So until the third day of testing, they wouldn't have received the redesigned seal. But when they received the redesigned seal, they found that it was also no good. So then they had to re-engineer the seal. Right. So it's a seal that has been redesigned, and on that redesigning of the seal, that redesigned seal had to be re-engineered. So it's it, but it seems probably weird.
Shape and materials.
Yeah,
I would assume.
Yeah, yeah. Some material science is there.
Something completely new.
Now we're talking about this, the McLaren Honda, that they're being very ambitious with their packaging, right? They're going size zero everything.
Tight. Yeah.
Yeah. So
the girdle on.
Yeah. Now, did this have anything to do with Alonso's crash?
I don't know.
Because
so much. Yeah. They don't obviously don't want to admit anything about the car breaking.
Yeah.
Or having some sort of failure.
Mike.
Especially since the dude was in the hospital for 2 or 3 days.
I don't know the exact number, like, Danny, you might remember, but from the beginning of 2014.
Yeah.
Last year we saw some new things appear on every single Formula One car. Like, there's these lights that now tell you if it's safe to approach the car. Like, just for anybody to see. Like, they just have these lights on top of the T-bar just to tell you if it's safe to even come close to the car. And they even tell the drivers that if you're getting off the car and the car, because the car has broke down, not to just, like, step out of the car, but to jump out.
Right.
The reason for that is because these cars are now, with all this energy recovery system, we're talking about thousands and thousands of volts, right?
It's the amperage.
Or the amperage.
That's why they have such fat. Electrical cables,
the looms.
Jesus Christ!
We're talking about like things.
The power cord, it's basically between the electric motor and the battery.
Right.
I don't know. I would like to know how many amps. They would never tell you, but it's got to be in the hundreds.
Right.
The DC amps.
That's crazy.
You don't want to get hit.
Now, what's fatal again? Is it like 0.2 amps fatal?
On eight with an AC, it's like a half an amp can kill you.
Yeah. So we're talking it's about
like from your wall socket. Anyone who's not on 220 in the world. 120 volt, half an amp will kill you. Or can. Like 3/4 of an amp basically will kill you.
That's crazy.
If you get it from hand to hand across your heart, and if you step out of the car, it's gonna go through your body.
Yeah.
Holy
the car is insulated from the ground by the rubber tires.
Can't you just wear some boots?
Their driving boots are very thin. Their driving boots
that much,
are
like, that much current will go right through. Yeah, just go right through the boot.
Yeah. So And we're talking about a seal that's supposed to be like affecting the integrity of the part of the car that retrieves some of the like the actual kinetic energy and turns it into electrical energy. It must have like so. Imagine one of those cables like going wild, hitting Alonso. I mean, I'm not saying that that's what happened, but maybe that has something to do with it, and that's what people are saying.
I don't know. I doubt it. But even the system that controls the steering wheel would be like a 24-volt system. Mm. It wouldn't feel good if it shorted through your fingers or something. It could have just like scared him for half a second, but it made him jump and then he lost control. You know, there's no onboard video that we can see anyway.
Yeah.
I don't know. Back up these numbers. I've been an electrician by trade. you don't want to touch electricity.
You don't.
I saw the craziest Reddit post, and it was like this woman in China, like on some sort of electrical thing, and she's like whacking it, it, and then just this lightning bolt stems from it and just attaches to her
eyes,
to her face, it's the only thing I've ever seen that looked like your soul was leaving your body.
Never climb up a power line.
No, that just seems like a bad idea.
Yeah, never do it.
Don't do it, kids.
Don't steal electricity.
Yeah,
you know what's dangerous. Funny?
Turn it off. Test.
My European relatives always make fun of us in North America because the majority of their power lines are actually underground.
Yeah.
And so in here, like, the power just goes down. People are like, well, shit, you have to, like, put it back up. And they just laugh. They just laugh. Laugh at us.
Remember last year, the ice storm?
Oh, yeah. See,
power lines are down everywhere.
That's exactly what we were talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, hilarious.
To them.
Yeah, to them, right? To them.
Well, Germany is also a very progressive country.
Oh, yeah, they got like six garbage disposals.
I tell you what, like, power lines in Spain are all over the place. They're like, basically. Yeah.
they're just fucking everywhere.
Yeah. day two of testing. What happened? Hamilton was better. He was feeling better. He did a few
blew his nose and had a nap, I guess.
Yeah, I guess so. He said he was feeling better
because he listened to the rest of the podcast.
Oh, of course.
so he knew.
They did still end up splitting that day in between him and Rosberg.
They're gonna say Roscoe.
Where is Roscoe? I thought Roscoe? That was like our Twitter.
No, it is. It's still
not ours. That's the
No, I know it's not ours, but it's something we have to keep up with.
Yes.
Yeah, where is Roscoe?
Where is, yeah, is Roscoe sick as well?
Everybody needs to know.
No, is Roscoe sick?
Who gave it to who?
Yeah.
Who had this cold first?
Oh, that's not how you spell it.
God damn it.
Alonso did manage to do, like, on this day too, before he got, you know, digging around by ambulance, he did 59 laps. He's still like a...
Check if it's been trending. Hashtag where's Rascal.
The one, other stuff happened during the second day of testing, but I think that more important action happened outside the track. At what I think is going to be a very momentous, interview in the history of F1 to come, and it's the Arriva Bene interview that happened that year, where he basically he comes out and he outlines the way that he's gonna think and the way that he's thinking about the you know the rest of the year. So Arriva Bene, first off, he started by saying that he doesn't blame Alonso for the problems that Ferrari had. He's clearly like. He's looking at it from a very, very top level. He's saying, you know what? Anybody in that situation, you've been in Ferrari for 5 years. Basically, the promise of Ferrari at that point had been, come to Ferrari, stay with us for 3 or 4 years. We'll get our shit together. We'll give you some championships. Mm-hmm. That didn't happen for Alonso.
Did not happen.
So obviously, and we're talking about a guy that. Through the last 2 years, and I remember that very clearly, the last 2 years that he was a Ferrari, so last year and the year before, every weekend, or at least every F1 weekend or every second F1 weekend, all, you know, the media, reporters, journalists, biographers, smart people all over the sport kept basically telling this dude, you are one of the best, if not the best on the grid. Mm-hmm. Like just to him, all the drivers respect you. Like you are undoubtedly, you've managed to do something that nobody would have thought possible with the car that you have. You are amazing. You're a genius. You're how do you do what you do? Martin Brundle brought him Brundle is not, I can tell Martin Brundle is not an Alonso fan, but he has a lot of respect for him, and one time he had him over on his in the Skype F1, and they went on this Skype ad that is basically a touchscreen TV, and they went through one of his starts and how he does his starts.
Watch the camera on that one.
Oh, okay,
that's all right because it's right.
Did I move it?
No, you put your fingers in front of it.
Oh, anyway,
it was funny. It was funny.
But. He basically was like, Alonso, show us how you do your starts, because he's known for gaining sometimes up to even 5 positions just from the start, just weaving through everybody.
It's pod racer shit right there.
Yeah, exactly.
Unless Grosjean's lurking.
Exactly. So, but here's a guy that he's been told, you're the best, you're one of the best, you should have by now 5 championships, but you only have 2. And that obviously had to have gotten to him. And Arriva Bene admits this. And he says that the environment that Ferrari was at, even if it was affected or not by Alonso being in a certain mood, it's something that they did to themselves, obviously, because the car just wasn't competitive. Mm-hmm. And he's man enough to admit that
they weren't even selling as many Ferraris into the public.
Yeah,
and Massa said, Massa said to Formula1.com, the official news, that he believes that when he was back at the team 2-3 years ago, that Alonso was trying to leave even then, but I guess they kept him there. Part of what he said was he kept trying to change the team. The car wasn't so good and the results weren't there, but he kept fighting. Well, but the team was already changing completely inside, and they decided to change in the end, even Alonso.
Yeah, and that is something that has, some people say that some drivers, if you have enough charisma, something like what Schumacher brought to Ferrari, and a lot of people obviously give that as the obvious example.
He's got a lot, too. He's He's good with the interviews at the end of the day. He runs into the crowd, shakes people's hands.
Yeah, exactly. But even
he's probably one of the best in that way.
Exactly. Yeah, and he knows how to play the politics of it somehow. Anyway, like just but drivers like that can actually like bring an extra bit of energy to the team.
Almost as many weird tweets as Hamilton.
Yeah.
Almost as many selfies.
I'm looking at his Twitter right now.
He just tweeted the same picture 3 times in a row there. Or what?
No, I think those were retweets.
Oh.
Yeah. Anyway,
he's in the studio. The
oh, that's a great one. Hold on. Let's go to that for a second.
This is his favorite place to be other than the car. Still, where's that mixtape? Hamilton?
What are you looking at?
I don't know. It might help if you take off that hat, bud.
Oh, is that? Oh, right. That hat is...
Oh, this is... Hey, soundboard. Tell me your secrets.
Tell me your secrets. Please.
I gotta hear a single from this guy. Come on. Where's...
Yeah,
YouTube, SoundCloud page.
It's my favorite place to be, my fortress of solitude.
Oh my god!
I don't know. I see some people.
Yeah, there's
in the
some
back.
People in the back.
What are you doing, man?
Maybe that's what he was doing when he had a fever.
I wanna
spit some rhyme.
I wanna say something because I feel that
none of these are on. By the way, if you look here, these are all like, if it's like a track. If he's like listening to something he made, it's on like the first like 10 or 12 channels, let's say. And so you can see like they're on over here, but these are not. he's sitting there because it looks cool. It looks cool as shit. Like, I'm not going to take it from that because it does look cool. But that's not where he's like, he's not mixing or anything.
That's not where the action is happening. But Mike knows
what he's talking about.
I'm going to take it back because probably that seat right there is where both the speakers are facing you. And in the proper proper region. So
he's got the remote within reach there.
Okay.
Is that the volume? Yeah. Mike's being to professional recording school.
Oh yeah.
He knows his shit.
Yeah.
I've seen one of these before.
I was saying that, you know, I don't want to be misunderstood here because
Misunderstood.
I think you were misunderstood.
Yeah. I don't want to be misunderstood here. Because it's not that I hate Hamilton. It's not that we don't like Hamilton. I think that, like I've said before, he is probably like one of the fastest guys in Formula One ever. He's a very committed guy to his sport. It's just that some of the shit he says and some of the stuff he posts on Twitter. Come on. I mean, we can't make this up. Look at this picture. Really?
Yeah, whatever.
he is probably a solid guy.
He's lovable too.
In a social situation, I don't think I'd like to have a pint with him, but
oh fuck, I'd sit down with him any day.
Yeah. Well, he probably doesn't drink beer. He probably like has like some sort of a cocktail or something, or drinks gin from the bottle like another rapper.
Oh, like those people who like drink liquor from their butts
with the tampons or what? Isn't that something that your people like devise? The Germans?
Oh, the Germans, they're crazy, man. They'll...
That's the other half of my blood. Yeah. That's the bottom half.
That's all of mine.
Oh, no. I'd rather sit down with this dude than Alonso, to be honest.
What?
Oh yeah,
Alonso probably doesn't drink either.
Yeah, I don't know. Whatever. I'd force him to. Either way, I'd sit down with him.
Yeah.
For a tea, we'll have an afternoon tea.
At 5 o'clock.
Couple.
Cheers to the queen.
Dippable biscuits.
Hey, I want to go back to that Arriba Bene interview before I forget, before we move on to something else.
That dude looked tired, by the way.
Who, Arriba Bene?
Yeah.
Apparently it was just really, really hot in that conference room, but I don't know.
Okay. Well, yeah. It was cold outside, so I think he wasn't sleeping.
Oh, no. I'm sure that since Arriba Bene like took the reins of Ferrari, like he hasn't been sleeping, because you got to think that he's with the team during testing, and then at night there's all kinds of different meetings that they're going to go out and attend, and then he has to sort out the deal like within his team. But I want to talk like real. Okay, so let me finish like going through like the points, the main points of that interviews with Arriba Bene. So he said a number a couple of things that I want to point out. Hang on, let me find myself here.
So I did see this interview, so I'm gonna take the opportunity to
Okay, so one thing, Matt, he says, talking about Manor F1, the old Marussia, he wants to back them up in their decision to come out to Formula One.
Mm-hmm.
He is doing that effectively by having an agreement with them that they will supply 2014 engines. Now, this is obviously, I mean, it's something that, that doesn't really cost Ferrari that much, and it means a lot for the team. So a lot of people are saying like, oh, why don't you give them the 2015 engines? Because it's a bankrupt team,
right?
So he's doing what he can do, and what he can do is they obviously have a number of engines from last year that are would still be legal this year.
They still work.
Yeah, they still work, and right. they still are within the rules.
Okay,
right, for this year.
Because I know they like to change those very often.
Right. Yeah. But the rules for the engines from last year are the same as this year. The only thing that changed was that thing with the token. So how much they could modify it.
Right.
But if you just leave it the same as last year, and raise a car with the same engine as last year, it's perfectly legal.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So
and you save all those tokens.
You would save all those development tokens if all of your teams, I guess, if all of the teams that use Ferrari like have done the same. But no, he's just giving the engines from last year. Unmodified, untouched. Here, Marussia, have it, and that's good for them because Marussia or sorry, Manor F1, now known as Marussia before, they raced with Ferrari engines. So one thing that I found key is that he did specify that they have nothing in writing now. They have nothing in writing yet, just kind of like a verbal agreement, because also Manor F1, we still don't know if they're actually going to come to F1, if their push is going to be like strong enough, but at least he backs them up and he says that as far as he's concerned, if they come knocking on his door and they want some engines, they will give him 2014 engines that are legal and they will still work.
Might be a little cheaper too.
Well, no, I think they're just going to give it to them. That's the thing. They're just going to give it to them.
Oh, wow.
Because, okay, so here's the thing. So this is Manor Marussia. They entered administration and their poise is set to exit administration.
Right.
But they're not, and this is what wasn't clear to me the last time that we got together for this. And I said something like, oh, maybe they've paid all their creditors or whatever. No, they haven't paid all their creditors. One of their biggest creditors of the old Marussia team, the Manor F1 team, are Ferrari and McLaren. And they've entered into an agreement.
I assume there was a bank or sort of investor.
Yeah. Well, I think that there are some investment houses, but either way, so they've entered into what's called, it's some sort of an agreement that the creditors are going to let them come out of administration. Even though the debts aren't fully repaid, the creditors are gonna let them come out of administration, and that's what got finalized basically last week or this week. And that's why Marussia's doors are looking more open. So and with this help from Arriba Bene saying that we'll just give you some 2014 engines or maybe even just one engine, even if it's just like one or two engines for the car, you're good. And they can make it. And if they make it, that's the thing. If they make it before Bahrain or at Bahrain, because according to Bernie Ecclestone, they're allowed to miss three races, they're still good. They can still get the prize money. Anyway, so he's good on that front. He doesn't have any problems with Manor F1 that way. He's also saying that that Kimi is smiling and he's even talking. He's even talking. Kimi Raikkonen is like, when we talked about the drivers like way earlier on, we described him as the Iceman, and a lot of people have this like outward perception because during interviews he like, he answers with like one or two like words.
Yeah. He keeps his hat like this. He's got big dark sunglasses on.
Sure.
One word answer.
Yeah. But he says, Kimi Raikkonen, he's smiling. He's even talking. So that must be a good thing. So this Arriba Bene said this.
Oh.
But he's kind of a cool guy. He's kind of a joker. He's pointing out something that's actually very, it's significant. And I actually want to take some time to explain one thing. Sorry, we're just taking tangents here. But
yeah,
Danny,
yeah.
Do you want to hold this? Okay, am I in frame here?
Yes, you are. You're good.
Okay, is this in frame?
Yep.
Okay, Danny, can you hold this notebook here? Sorry, this is your notebook.
Yes.
Because I have brought...
Hold the notebook.
I brought props for today. These are two clementines. And I'm going to stab with two pens.
You get juice.
This is going to be a really good analogy.
Okay, so... Kimi Raikkonen, and this is what I'm going to say.
I'm very okay with this. Yeah, this is awesome.
Kimi Raikkonen.
It reminds me of Halloween, actually.
Yeah, pull this up. Okay, so Kimi Raikkonen. Are you getting this, Mike?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, so Kimi Raikkonen last year had a big problem with the car, and he kept complaining over and over and over again because he said that the front end of the Ferrari wasn't to his liking. Now, from what I understood on a video that I watched, I think it was on Peter Windsor's channel, the Racing Edge. If you haven't checked it out yet, you gotta, because it's amazing.
It's pretty
but
great.
Yeah, what one of his guests is explaining is that, let's consider this as the Ferrari front suspension.
Okay.
So this is the Ferrari front suspension from last year.
Do you look like the wheels?
You know what I mean?
Are those supposed to be wheels?
Fantastic. Yeah, yeah. The Clementines are the wheels. This is the suspension. So okay. Independent of whether it's pull rod or push rod,
okay.
Eventually the suspension is going to kind of look like this in the geometry and like do this to the car, right? Like
right.
You're going
okay.
around, right? That's a suspension. The suspension of last year's Ferrari was pretty high.
Okay.
Right? Regardless of pusher or puller rod, it was pretty high compared to this year. And what kept happening last year, okay, so let's say last year was like this and Kimi Raikkonen didn't like it, and this year they're more like down here.
Oh shit.
Stiffer suspension.
Yeah.
Kimi Raikkonen likes it a lot. But they made a point, and it's very, very valid, because when it was up here,
yeah,
every time that you're braking, the weight of the car comes to the front and it does this. By doing this, and you can tell this, Danny, like from holding.
Yeah, it pushes the tires.
Yeah,
out.
It pushes the tire far, and there was a significant amount of force that had to be borne by the sidewalls of the tires, just from me being like this, right? Like from going like that, boom.
Flattening out the camber of the wheels.
And now imagine doing this, like braking, like
especially if you're braking into a corner.
Exactly. When you're braking into a corner,
your outside tire is going to be on an angle.
And that's what you saw all of last year, was Kimi Raikkonen losing the car at corners.
Now they have the tires cambered so that they're mostly touching the ground.
So imagine going, 300 kilometers an hour, like speed, like slowing down to like 60 from 300 to 60, and at the same time trying to turn left or right, and your tires are doing this thing that they're basically losing grip, they're locking up. It's a disaster. So they've managed to figure out a way, Ferrari, to basically run them as low as they can right now, like very, very, very low, so that whenever that happens, that they break, it's going to be such a small change that it's not affecting the drivability. Mm. And that is what has Kimi Raikkonen happy.
Maybe a little more bumpy, but...
Yeah. It's definitely going to be a lot stiffer of a suspension. A lot stiffer of a suspension, for sure.
That was fantastic. Thank you. You really explained a lot to me.
Anyway... and one thing actually that going back to Arriva Bennett, so one thing that I remember is that over the weekend I was at Danny's and we were watching the Senna documentary again, Mike, we will watch the Senna documentary, you will see it, like it's really cool. And Arriva Bennett was actually there. He was from back in the Senna days, he was already associated with Ferrari, albeit that's because Ferrari had the Marlboro sponsorship, and that was like back when Arriva Bennett was associated with Marlboro, but he was at the track, he was wearing the Ferrari livery, he was around. He's been looking at the development of Ferrari even, so that was early 90s. From the early 90s till now, he's been looking, that's 20-something odd years, that he's been looking at how Ferrari has evolved as an outsider, and clearly Sergio Marchionne, a guy that is a shooter and like tells him how it is, likes him because he does the same thing, and he brought him to Ferrari. And now, okay, what else did he say? He says that Rory Byrne is coming back to Ferrari. Now, Rory Byrne, I think I got a picture of him. Did I send the picture?
You're not. I don't think so.
No. Okay. Anyway, so Rory Byrne has been Rory.
Wait,
R-O-R-Y.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, B-Y. Yeah, there he is. Rory Byrne. There he is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, so Rory Byrne, he's...
That's crazy.
He's an F1 designer.
Okay.
Right? He's up there with Adrian Newey. I think he's his status that he's third in the amount of championships that he has won.
By design.
By design, like his the cars that he's designed, whatever, have won so many championships that puts him at third, only behind Adrian Newey. That's undisputedly the king, and then mm-hmm. Colin Chapman, who won his championships in the 70s. So completely different cars. So let's say that in between, it was basically in between him and Newey, they were the best of the modern F1 cars. He was at Ferrari during the early 2000s and late 90s. The push, it was part of what they called the dream team of Ross Brawn, and that's when Schumacher was in Ferrari. Okay. And that's when with Ferrari they won 5 championships in a row with his cars. Now he retired after that, and clearly something that Arriva Bene said must have convinced him to come back as a he's over 70 now, but
it's probably something that he gave him.
Well, but he's coming back in a
pile of cash.
He's South African, so obviously, to come from South Africa to Maranello, Italy, it takes a little bit.
Big pile of lira.
Yeah, and he's come back on a sort of a mentorship position for the current designers, for the guys that are going to be working at the car. I kind of just push them in the right direction, not necessarily design the car itself, but at least talk to them. Another thing that Arriva Bene has been working on is that he has worked on the management structure inside Ferrari, mm-hmm. and he has let James Allison, who is now the technical director of Ferrari, by all means a very brilliant guy, but he's
great beard too.
No, he doesn't have a beard. James Allison, no. But either way, he's allowed Allison to approach the design of the car and the technicalities of the car mm-hmm. from every direction that he wants now. Because I guess before, Ferrari used to be separated by in different departments, or it was very strict before Arriva Bene. And Arriva Bene has changed that, and now he has allowed Allison to come at the design of the car from an engine perspective, from aerodynamics perspective, from suspension, from everything that affects the design of the car. And we're seeing that already. I think this Ferrari, this year's Ferrari, looks very, very strong.
Yeah.
And another thing that he said that they're gonna do for the now for the future is, remember last year when Ferrari was using their own revamped wind tunnel plus a Toyota wind tunnel in Germany, and they kept coming up to testing with all kinds of different wings and all kinds of different parts just to try to be let's see what works. And that was that was a pad fry mentality.
Yeah.
That's gone from Ferrari. They're saying that they're going to focus on one or two parts, bringing a lot less parts per race, but parts that will work. So just a different thinking for Ferrari. This all just makes sense. It looks like it's gonna work, and it looks like the Ferrari is finally gonna go up there. And even right now, people are saying that it's maybe not necessarily up there, but up to second to Mercedes. And I'll be looking forward to that, because that will, if anything, spice up the championship. Just seeing Raikkonen and Vettel.
Yeah, personally, I'm not the biggest Mercedes fan, but I'd love to see some more competition between teams this year.
You mean you're not the biggest Ferrari fan?
Ferrari fan, what did I say?
From Mercedes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not the biggest Mercedes fan either, to be honest. But, well, anyway.
Another thing that came out from that interview that I'd like to point out.
But Ferrari,
the last thing that I want to point out from the interview is that apparently Vettel wasn't completely sold on going to Ferrari until he got a call from Sabine Kemp, who's Schumacher's former management when she was involved with the Ferrari days.
So
apparently it wasn't until she called him and talked to him and said listen, I know Ferrari, I know how it's gonna be there, because Ferrari was looking like a shaky decision last year for Vettel. For the Vettel fans, they were
definitely
they said, why don't you stay at Red Bull? So it wasn't until Sabine Kemp, Schumacher's manager, and we know that Vettel looks up to Schumacher. It's in his helmet.
In his helmet.
Yeah. And then he got a call from Sergio Marchionne, chairman of Ferrari, CEO of Fiat, that he's basically after that, he knew, okay, yeah, now I have to go to Ferrari. Now I got to say something, because Sergio Marchionne is, and you can tell from his interviews that he's very convinced that the Vettel and the investment in Vettel will pay off. Marchionne, yeah, that's him.
It seems like him and Raikkonen have at least more similar...
Oh, family man.
Yeah, this guy. But no, but he seems
like
convinced.
Him and Raikkonen have a lot more similar driving styles, at least than like him and Alonso had last year.
Yeah, for sure.
Alonso seemed to be doing all right, and Iceman was kind of... seemed like he was on ice for real a lot of the time.
But here's something that Marchionne has said that at least I... a guy like this guy with so much on his plate, you know, being Ferrari chairman and CEO of Fiat and Chrysler, he apparently, like, his deal is that when Fiat and Chrysler had their headquarters separate in Chrysler obviously in Detroit, and Fiat in Turin, Italy, he would fly pretty much every day in his private jet from Turin, Italy to Detroit, and all the sleep he got was the sleep that he got on the airplane in between. Oh, otherwise, he was always working. So he probably has too much on his plate to watch Formula One.
Yeah, too much
on his plate to know. And so
just the highlights.
And being a CEO, being a business guy.
Yeah.
And he's a certified Ontario accountant. Like he's Canadian, Italian.
I remember this guy.
Yeah. He's an accountant. He probably just sees the numbers and he says, a guy that has four world championships, how could we go wrong? Of course we're gonna have some triumph with Vettel. And I say no, because Vettel got his championships handed to him because of the brilliance of Newey. That's my opinion.
Yeah, we're gonna find out.
I think
there was a lot of talk last year.
Let's put a beer on it. I think that by the end of this year, Raikkonen's
gonna beat him.
Raikkonen's gonna do better than Vettel.
I'm gonna say no.
Well, I don't. Let's put a beer on that.
Yeah, we'll put a beer on it.
Yeah, there we go.
It's not gonna happen.
No, it will happen. It's happening. I'm telling you.
Both. I don't know. Well, it's hard to tell because they both performed in the past and they both did bad last year. And they both had babies.
That's true. They're fathers now.
Which I don't know. I think that would probably slow them down, but. At least for the first year.
I think so, man. Like you're gonna approach a corner like spoon, you know, flat out, and then all of a sudden an image of your baby comes to your mind. Like, oh, I better slow down. I don't want to die. My baby.
I don't know. They both seem to be comfortable, but I think Vettel's gonna smash him.
We'll see. We'll see.
Yeah. I think so, man.
Yeah.
We will see. I don't know. We'll see.
What else happened that day? Ericsson did over 100 laps in the Sauber. You know, good for him. Again, proving the reliability, the new reliability of the new Ferrari engine. Joelen Palmer was in the Lotus.
He looks like a baby, too.
Yeah. He's young. He came from winning GP2 last year.
Yeah.
McLaren's Eric Bouyer was quoted saying that we're talking about day two. He's saying, so the halfway point of all the testing, they only have what, 6 more days to go. He's saying that they've only done 50% of what they set out to do. Their testing program is like they've only done 50%, but
yeah,
being halfway through doing 50%, I mean,
it's like when you install a program on Windows and it, like, hopefully for them anyway, then it jumps to the end. It's kind of like you're like, when's this gonna be done?
I have high hopes for McLaren Honda. I think that once they iron out their little details,
I'm for as much competition as these teams can muster against each other. Especially, and once again, I'm trying to sell a Honda Accord. Send me an email. It's got every option. Just put a new battery in it too. $6,000.
What else? Okay, so day three. What do we got? Day three. Teams are starting to wrap up their program at this stage. McLaren. That's when McLaren got their new seal fitted. But now they figured out that they have to re-engineer the seal because it didn't work quite as well.
Didn't work either.
Yeah.
Again, Button only did 45 laps.
Yep.
He did about, oh, whatever. A really low amount.
Horner, Christian Horner, was quoted saying, this one, like, the car that they were testing there will not be the car that's going to be on track at Melbourne. So yeah, this loss of development that they're expecting in the front wing, even, like, that just down to, they're still working on a different car. And actually, you could tell because, I mean, you look at that Red Bull and you see a lot of elements from last year, even.
See a lot of elements of a zebra, too.
That Red Bull could be hunted with a gun.
It's meant to scare and confuse the other drivers.
It's like an African horse running around.
What else we got? Sauber also engine problems. And it's actually funny because at this point, so Sauber had a problem also with their with the gearbox, and they only brought two gearboxes to the event. So the one gearbox conked out, then the second gearbox conked out, and they didn't have any more. So a guy had to go all the way to HQ of Sauber, which is in Switzerland, and drive it back.
Drove back with it?
Just drove back with this.
I didn't hear that.
Yeah, and they, obviously, like, it was a long drive, so they couldn't have it until the next day.
Wow.
So yeah, they sat out the rest of the season of testing.
I guess they're not going around with a whole bunch of transmission parts anymore either, because all the gears are fixed.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I guess so.
You just bring a complete sealed unit and that's it.
Yeah.
And not expect it to break after a few laps.
Red Bull continuing to struggle. Very early in the morning. Not so many changes in their engines since last year came out.
Again, Renault's hoarding tokens.
Yeah, we're... It's a waiting game for Red Bull. Frank Williams was in the gear in the grid somehow. He was just, I guess, looking at his team, which is looking very promising. The Williams, again, looking pretty good. Alonso was hanging out with the sciences. And the fourth day was basically much of the same, except for that 30G crash that Alonso suffered.
Yeah.
Too bad.
Which we covered.
The rest was basically like pretty much what had happened. Just, again, Red Bull with problems. Mercedes doing some good laps. Again, Grosjean, I think that's when he put that. That's when he clocked that fastest lap. That is not representative at all because obviously Mercedes can do faster. But we do have the numbers now. Again, and I say this, it's incredible that so many cars are faster than the fastest time last year.
I expect every single car next week will break that qualifying time.
Yeah.
I think so.
Could be.
I think so.
That's what happened in testing, if you missed it.
That's what happened. Let's talk about helmets for a second, because last week we talked... It's kind of weird, because I've never really considered... Well, aside from this new ruling and Vettel switching it up all the time, I've never really considered the helmets too much. And we mentioned that they might all be shoe berths. I got some links for you here. Not super important, but... that they might all be shoe berths. But it seems like this week, Checo switched from an Arai to a shoe berth.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't like it and went back. And Hamilton switched from an Arai to a Bell. I don't know. Maybe something's up with the new Arais, but I don't know. Maybe the Bell's better than the shoe berth. Check your... I just sent it to you right now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can close all that stuff that we're doing. It's kind of hard to find... I was trying to find information about... which drivers are using which helmets, but
sorry,
there's a Yasuhisa Arai.
Yasuhisa,
I'm sorry, who is the Honda Motorsports chief. Okay, this is a little animation.
It's not on yet.
Okay.
It's on you guys.
Yeah, I was trying to find information about who's wearing Arais, who's wearing Schuberts, who's wearing Bells, but these dudes, Bob Bell, who's the tech chief of Mercedes, and Yasuhisa Arai made it a little difficult. I couldn't find a list anywhere, but
yeah, anyway. It's weird that they don't advertise that more, like who's got who's. But
you want this one?
Yeah,
we can look at that for a second. This is somebody made this I think today on... I found this on Reddit. These are 75 of Hamilton's different Vettel's helmet designs.
Oh wow,
which have now been banned, but you can see how crazy he went.
But it doesn't seem crazy to me, but I obviously don't know everything there is to know about it.
75 different ones. Basically, he's the only guy that was... He was switching them almost every weekend, sometimes...
Oh, really?
Twice a weekend.
Jesus.
But, like I said, I'm sure one day he's going to give these to his kids.
Oh, this is all 75?
Yeah, it just keeps looping.
Oh, my God.
But, yeah, he's really the only guy who's been doing it. And I'm sure he's the catalyst for the new ruling of one helmet per guy per year. But I found out today the penalty for changing your helmet is, I think, a donation to charity. So he came out in public and said that, whatever, if that's the only penalty, he's going to change his helmet anyways. Nice. But at the same time, he's got the Schumacher tribute helmet he's wearing now. He said he's going to stick with for the year.
Jesus.
But look at them.
Yeah, but they're a lot.
But yeah, basically he's the only guy that's been doing it. But I don't know, people say it gets confusing, going back and forth. Another thing we talked about last week was the
wing. The Red Bull is always there and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you're looking at the car, but yeah, there's two cars the same. So
I guess you're right.
We talked about this last week. Go back for one sec. If you look at the back of the helmet, that little wing there.
Yeah, this thing here.
When you're going really fast, the helmet tries to like suck itself off your head, right?
Oh, really?
Yeah. So basically, that wing, when you get to high speed, pushes it back down, like gives it some downforce.
Ah, okay.
So if you go to those next two tweets, they're from Tobias Gruner. These are the two Red Bulls. They've experimented with removing that wing from the helmet, and that's some Flo-Viz paint there. So if you go to the next picture, you can see better. Right above it's from the wrong angle. Right above the driver's head, though, basically right behind his head, is intake for some kind of cooling. It's obviously something important because as soon as the car stops, they shove in that turbo fan to blow air down the hole.
Right.
But basically that wing on their helmet was causing the wind to not go into that hole. They're having some cooling problems.
Oh, crazy.
So they've tried removing it. So I guess, I don't know. These two drivers said it's not too big of a deal with the extra...
But it's still probably pulling the hell in.
They said it's not too uncomfortable. So, whatever.
That means that it probably is. They just don't want to say because they're drivers.
Yeah, it's probably pulling really hard. But anyway, that's all about the helmets.
it is very interesting though that they're playing around with that, because like I thought that the reason that those wings were there was also to direct airflow around the car. Around the car better, but I guess, I mean, part of it also, I mean, it may be that too, but part of it also is...
If you look at like even like a motorcycle helmet or something, they have a similar bit of wing on the back of it.
Yeah, it's just so it doesn't strangle you, I guess, because it works like an airplane wing. It gets lift. Yeah. Yeah. Honda engine.
The Honda engine. What you get?
Well, okay, so here's the thing, right? So we're... And engines in general.
The seal problem.
Yeah, so we know right now that the date of homologation, you know, the thing that affects the tokens and whatever, date for homologation is written on the F1 sporting regulations as being February 28, 2014, except for Honda, it's actually written February 28, 2015. But it so happens that if you look at a calendar, February 28 is a Saturday. So because February 28 is a Saturday and the FIA doesn't work on weekends, their date for homologation is actually being pushed back to the Monday.
Yeah. Oh man.
Yeah. So this is it's so It's so
Every
stupid.
Edge.
It's so stupid. But
so Honda's gonna get about 48 extra hours. To homologate,
to work on the engine. I mean, they must be glad, because I mean, if you're working flat out all the time, 20 like you know around the clock at an engineering department, 24 hours can make a difference.
Right.
Something that might help you out.
Yeah.
Since we're having such problems with the Japanese names, Takenobu Ito has left Honda. Did you know this?
No.
We were talking about this guy last week. He was the guy who works at Honda, who is responsible for F1's return, the architect of their F1 program.
Oh, yeah.
And he was also the main guy who was supporting the signing of, or the re-signing, I guess, of Fernando Alonso.
Right. So but, he's out?
Yeah, he left. He's going to be replaced. Who knows with who, or if hopefully this guy will have, I'm sure he will, but the same passion for F1 that Takenobu did. He actually appeared at every single official event presentation.
Oh, yeah.
And display that Honda has done in the last few months. But basically, I don't know if anyone knows, if you own basically a Civic, an Accord, Acura EL, a bunch of those cars, you should look online and check out your VIN number, whether or not it's affected by a recall. There's a gigantic recall. It's probably going to... Honda is one of the biggest companies that's affected. I think like hundreds of millions of dollars worth of airbags are fucked.
Oh, I heard about that, actually.
God damn.
Yeah, so I guess he's been under a lot of pressure. He's, I guess he's responsible.
In a way?
In a way. He's succumbed to the pressure, as the quote says. And the scandals cost them majillions of dollars.
I bet.
But yeah, he's been the man for Honda in coming back to F1, and he's gone.
Ooh, yeah.
You don't have to worry about pronouncing his name anymore.
That
the next guy might have less syllables.
But it's not Arai. It's not Arai, is it?
No, Takenobu Ito.
Oh,
Ito.
Okay.
This guy, he's the above him.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Arai is the engine chief, right?
No, he's the motorsport chief.
Motorsport chief.
Yeah.
He is the entire
the Honda guy.
Honda F1 guy. The entirety of F1, including drivers and everything.
True.
He's gone.
Shit.
So yeah, who knows what's that's gonna mean for the development of the engine even.
Yeah. Well, that's true. Yeah.
He's been the guy that's been pulling resources from Honda, right?
That's true. Yeah.
I'm sure he has meetings. We need more money, right? Need more money. He's gone. And I think I'm sure part of that airbag thing was his fault.
Yeah. Well, if he's succumbing to the pressure.
Yeah. It's not only Honda that's affected by them. The airbags, I think, are made by a third party that are installed in Hondas and a couple other brands of cars, which I'm not sure. Check your VIN number. My Accord is not affected, by the way.
Which is still for sale.
Just still for sale.
Going back to F1.
Wait, that's F1.
Yeah, that is F1. Another thing that is interesting about these tokens thing is that so the FIA scrutineers, they've been checking the Mercedes, Ferrari, and Renault engines for, among other things, things like the installation, reliability, and performance. They do this every year. Just they're scrutineers. They have to go in and measure all kinds of stuff, right?
Yeah.
But they figure right now, they figure that the calculations of the tokens that each team has spent vary from the calculations that the scrutineers have done of what tokens, of what counted as a change and what counted as tokens by two or three tokens every single team. So every single engine. So basically we're in a position right now. And this is something that, obviously, I mean, you're talking about the FIA or this the strategy group or whatever. These are politicians, essentially,
right?
Sitting at the very top, looking at an engine as a very simplistic thing and saying, okay, we're going to assign, however many tokens to the internal combustion engine, and out of that, a piston gets these many tokens, whatever. They're looking at it from a very top level. And obviously, when these regulations get handed out to the engineers, they actually look at them and say things like, well, actually, a piston or something is infinitely more complex than this.
Yeah.
What do you mean a change if it's been changed like this or it's been changed like that? Anyway, so they figure so that, yeah, I know, they figure that the way that the engineers of each team calculated it, they calculated it to be like two or three tokens less than what the FIA calculates it to be. And obviously, at the end of the day, the scrutineers are the ones that have the final word.
Right.
Even as vaguely as we talked about this a few weeks ago, we spent almost half an hour going over the list of how many tokens are each part is worth. And
each one of those parts, I even noticed it when I was reading through the list. Each one of those parts could actually be like many, many different little parts inside, right?
Yeah, some of them. Of course. Especially something like a piston that's different types of metal and
geometries. So
it's insane.
So they're saying that all teams, the way that it stands right now, the way that, what they've scrutinized, they're two or three tokens short of what they should be. So what's going to go in the books is going to be two or three tokens more, which means that Honda is going to get two or three tokens less to play around with. Whatever the number is, it's probably going to be two or three tokens less than they probably were expecting giving this.
I can't wait to find out how many especially Renault now that they've been talking about saving some. Yeah. I can't wait to see the numbers.
Yeah, yeah. Let's see those numbers. Well, we will see them by Australia.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Can't wait. 3 more weeks or something.
And that is that's what I got.
We're at 2 or 3 more small things. We can talk about that dashboard. Did we have that link?
Oh my god. Okay. I just sent it to you.
You should have 2 links. While you find the other one, we can talk. The latest one I sent you is about 3 teams' camera mounts. Yeah, we only really need this picture because the other pictures aren't very good.
This is good, actually.
Yeah, Toro Rosso's already fixed theirs, but Ferrari and Mercedes have... We talked about this, I guess, when we went over the cars the first week of testing. Those ears, and you can see in the top picture there.
Yes, okay, so you see these... No, go back.
Yeah, those ears as well.
Well, yeah, these are crazy. These are the Ferrari and Mercedes both have ears like that.
See, these are supposed to be the camera mounts that FOM can put cameras in. Last year they were supposed to rotate 360 degrees, right?
Some of them are.
Is that certain teams or?
No, I think
they can put whatever camera they want that mount.
They tested it extensively on the Williams, but yeah, they're supposed to be able to put whatever camera they want there.
Right, that's the mount.
On either side.
Yeah, so Toro Rosso, Mercedes, and Ferrari here have put these ears on it, basically tried to use the camera mounts as wings and for extra downforce and airflow management.
And that just recently got shut down.
Yeah, it's probably pushing extra air into those radiators on the side and across the arms of the suspension.
And you can see them, like, these are clearly, they're not, these are serving an aerodynamic purpose.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, and they got sort of away with that last year. But now, if you go back to like that, it's within that same window. Sorry, go back.
Oh, back. Yeah. We thought we had the technical problems fixed.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So see how like this team had them. So this is Toro Rosso. They had sort of like that. But then if you scroll down, so they basically the FIA is telling them no, they have to be just camera mounts. They have to just be straight like that. No aerodynamic gains.
Yeah. Toro Rosso had this fixed for Barcelona, and I guess Mercedes and Ferrari have promised they'll have theirs done by next testing period.
Crazy.
But I don't know why. I don't know. I guess they thought they could get away with it, or they wouldn't have bothered testing with that, right?
Oh, no. These were perfectly legal last year, right? Because that's what Mercedes had last year.
Yeah, I don't know. This article is in German, but basically the mounts are not supposed to be longer than 15 millimeters to the camera pod, and those are obviously way longer. Or they tried to go with a 15, I don't know,
millimeter, like, of this distance,
with that distance, and then added a curve to it. Who knows?
That's not allowed anymore.
Not allowed. And finally, Wolff and Hamilton going back and forth. They still haven't signed a contract.
Oh man.
Yeah, they thought that this was done, I guess, in Jerez. They were passing some numbers back and forth.
Oh yeah, we played.
Ted happened to catch it on camera during his.
No, that was Toby. Tobias Gruner. He caught it.
Oh, there was during. Oh,
and Ted during, too, I guess. Yeah.
During his walk, they sort of like pointed the camera into the while they're eating dinner there. Wolf and him. Yeah, basically, I guess. Wolf. This article. I don't know. I think he did this interview just to sort of squash any tension, because at the end he says he was asked. He sort of like made some waves rocking the boat a little bit. He was asked if Lewis goes somewhere else, if he doesn't sign the contract. And although it's not likely, he said, in his opinion, Fernando Alonso or Valtteri Bottas would be logical options to replace him.
Of course, yeah.
But he clarifies, I said nothing more than that. If you trust your relationship, you don't need to play any games, even though it's a business. But I guess they're talking tough because Hamilton doesn't have a agent anymore and a manager.
Mm.
So he's negotiating for himself.
He wants to be his own manager, like Vettel is.
Yeah, so he's negotiating for himself, but I guess it's got to be difficult. And, for the team, because like they said, they don't want to piss him off. They could say whatever they want to his manager, right?
Yeah.
And then deny it afterwards. Well, I guess that's the show. Check us out. Send us some emails.
Yes.
FlatoutFever@gmail.com.
We always welcome your comments, suggestions, whatever you got, good or bad, whatever. We'll at least read it. You have that. Mike, bless out.
Flat Out Fever on Twitter. Flat Out Fever on Reddit. Look out for MP3s and a website coming up.
Oh, yeah, we will have a big website announcement soon.
So listen to Bamboo. Check out this baseline.
Listen to Bamboo.com. If you like Mike's band, actually, like they're playing at the Silver Dollar at March 6th.
Oh, thank you.